Amen. Thank you, choir. As many of you know, I have a terrible sense of direction. Clint Eastwood, who's my favorite theologian, said that a man's got to know his limitations. And I do. I get lost. I've been lost in the woods so many times. One particular night, I was hunting in Citrus County, and very unsuccessful. I was cold. I was hungry. All I wanted to do was to get back to my truck and go home. And my flashlight quit working. And so I'm stumbling around, trying to keep from falling, and I keep walking. And somehow, which is easy for me, I got turned around. I didn't know which way I should go. That didn't keep me from continuing to walk, though. And finally, I came to a little road, and I followed it, and there's a gate, and I could see Highway 41 beyond it, and I realized I had walked right past my truck. That's what happens when you paint it camouflage. But anyway, the point that I'm telling you this is that before Christ has saved us, we're all just like that. We're walking around in the dark, aimlessly, not knowing which way to go, and not realizing that we're walking directly to the pit of hell itself. Paul is talking about us walking in the light of Christ now that we are saved. He is writing to believers. Today's passage is Ephesians 5, verses 1 through 21. It's God's holy word. It's inspired. It's inerrant, and it's infallible. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. But sexual immorality and all impurity or covetousness must not even be named among you as is proper among saints. Let there be no filthiness, nor foolish talk, nor crude joking, which are out of place. But instead, let there be thanksgiving. For you may be sure of this, that everyone who is sexually immoral or impure or is covetous, that is an idolater, has no inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not become partners with them. For at one time you were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true, and try to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful to even to speak of the things that they do in secret. But when everything is exposed by the light, it becomes visible. For anything that becomes visible is light. Therefore, it says, awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wow. May God add his blessing, the reading of his holy word. Pray with me, God. We ask that you would descend upon us with your Spirit, Lord, that you would open our hearts and our eyes and our minds to hear your word, and Lord, if necessary, to convict us, to encourage us, and to draw us closer to you. We ask this in Christ's name, amen. You may be seated. Last week we heard from Pastor Anthony about taking off the old and putting on the new, and we learned that resistance to God's plan and resistance to the work that he is doing within us indeed grieves the Holy Spirit. And this passage continues the same thought, and it says, we must walk as children of light. Verse 8 says, for at one time you were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. And it's a good summary. This whole passage, this first part of Ephesians 5, is that Paul says, you are children of the light, now live like it. He gives us a whole series of do this and not this. In this passage, it says in verse 4, instead of filthiness, foolish talk, and crude joking, give thanksgiving. In verse 11, he says, instead of taking part in the unfruitful works of darkness, expose them. Verse 17, he says, instead of being foolish, understand God's will. And in verse 18, he says, instead of getting drunk, be filled with the Spirit. The principle is that every day of our lives, we have hundreds of choices to make. And we have to choose as children of the light and not those who are still walking in the darkness. Am I going to watch this TV show? Am I going to watch this movie or not? Is this going to bring honor to God? Or is this possibly going to put some bad ideas into my head? Am I going to this particular establishment for wings? Or are there reasons there I don't need to be there? Am I going to hang around with this group of friends? Even though I realize that when I'm with them, I'm more likely to think, say, or do things that are not good. Am I going to go hunting on Sunday morning? Or am I going to go to church? Am I going to be bold and invite these people to come to church with us? Or am I not? And it goes on and on and on of all the choices we have to make in our lives. And sometimes it seems difficult. But these are real, everyday situations that we all live with. And we have to decide what we're going to do. If we make a commitment to walk as children of light, then it makes it a lot easier for us and how we're going to decide things. We have to understand what that means. And Paul is very clear to us. You can't do it yourself. You need help. We need each other. And this has been a constant theme of Paul, is that we are a body of believers brought together to help one another. We need accountability. It's so easy to fall into habits that are not becoming Christians. You know that's true, right? It's not a hard thing. How many Sundays does it take where you stay home in bed before that becomes a habit? And you forego the coming together to worship the Lord. It's easy to do. It's what I call the law of Christian gravity. If you're not moving towards Christ, you're falling away from him. And so we need to just absolutely fill ourselves with God's word, to spend time in prayer, to spend time in fellowship with other believers. I need somebody to keep me on the right path. You never get to the point where, okay, I've got it made now, and I've got this thing figured out. We need each other. You need someone to hold you accountable and to ask you the hard questions sometimes, and to know that they're doing that in love because they're part of the same body with the same goals, which are to move forward to again become the image of Christ, to walk as indeed, if we're in the light, our natural inclination is to go back and to do the things that we did, to say the things that we say, to watch the things that we watched before we were saved. And we're surrounded by it. It's not like you have any relief or there's a safe haven to go to, because everywhere has the world coming in, and what the world says is okay is not what God says is okay. Who you hang out with is important. Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians 6, 14 through 16. He says, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. Now, normally we take that to mean don't get married to somebody who's not a believer. But it goes way beyond that. He says, for what partnership is righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship is light with darkness? What accord is Christ with Belial? And what portion does a believer share with an unbeliever? What agreement has the temple of God with idols? For we are the temple of the living God. One of our greatest temptations in walking with the Lord comes from our friends who are non-believers. I found out how quickly when God saved me, and I hung with the same group of people, and it wasn't long. I remember going home one night from a runner's club meeting, and I'm saying, I cannot believe I just told that joke. But it was who I was with, and everybody else was telling them, and I wanted to be part of the crowd. And I said something that was embarrassing, not just to me, but to the body of believers. And so we have to be careful with who we hang with. Paul says, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not become partners with them. Now, we're not to separate ourselves from them so far that we never have an opportunity to bring them the gospel. But the people who are the closest to you, those that you can encourage and be encouraged by, need to be believers in Christ and walking on the same path as you. They should have the same goal of you, which is our sanctification, as we walk together as children of the light. Paul goes on to say, we must be imitators of God. Verse 1, he says, therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children. Now, you know that children imitate their parents. Isn't that right? You've seen that. I remember that when my granddaughter was 2 years old, Sandy and I noticed that every time she got out of her little chair, she would groan. And we said, man, we need to have her checked out. There's got to be something physically wrong with her. And then we realized that's what we did. You do that just naturally as you get older. And it was just a situation that she had learned that from us. I was reading my Bible in my chair one time, and I got up to go get a drink of water, and I came back. She's sitting in my place with my Bible. Now, she can't read, and she's got it upside down. If you look closely, you can see that. But she's going to imitate Grandpa. She saw me going hunting all the time. She said, I want to go hunting. So I took her out and got her a BB gun and tried to teach her to hunt. And kids imitate us. My daughter was little. She walked around. I heard this clumping noise. She's wearing my boots, and she wanted to bake because Sandy was always baking cookies. So we got her this little, you've seen these little ovens, they got a light bulb in them so the kids can't hurt themselves. And they give you these little recipes. And these were the worst cookies I ever had. But she was imitating her mother. Wait, not that mom's cookies were bad. Kids try to imitate parents and grandparents. And hopefully what they see us doing are godly things that lead them eventually to that saving relationship with Christ. That they learn the heart of givers and not takers. That's what Paul is saying to us. He says, be like children. To little kids, their parents are everything to them. And Paul is saying that God is everything to us, and therefore we should imitate him. And the first way that we do that is by love. Look at verse 2. It says, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. And we have to understand what kind of love that is. I was 32 years old when my daughter was born. And I'd been married 7 years, so I thought I was an expert at love, right? But when I carried her out of the delivery room, for the first time in my life, I understood the biblical teaching of unconditional love. Because here was this little kid that couldn't do one thing for me. And yet I had a love that was beyond any understanding. And I realized that's the love that Christ has for us. That's the sacrificial love that caused him to be born as a man and to come here and to sacrifice himself for us. It certainly wasn't anything we did for him. Because before he saved us, we could do nothing but sin. Isaiah says, all of our righteous acts are as filthy rags. And that's the condition that we were in. This little baby threw up on me. I didn't even care. Now, being a first-time father, I thought that we needed to rush her to the hospital. I didn't realize babies do that all the time. Thankfully, somebody was more sensible than me. But I cleaned up all kind of messes, disgusting stuff, and I didn't care. And as a parent, that's what you do. As a parent, you learn sacrifice. Actually, as a husband and a wife, you should learn the same things. To give to one another. Next week, we're going to talk about that relationship between a husband and a wife. It is a sacrificial love for each other. I know that she needed braces, and I didn't have the money to get braces. And so, you know, my prized possession at that time was this brand new Colt Python. Okay, this is the best handgun ever made. Okay, and I didn't even hesitate. I sold it to get her braces. You don't even think about it as a sacrifice. Because when you love somebody more than yourself, you're willing to do anything for them. And God showed us that as Jesus gave himself for us. All we can do in our lives is try to imitate that kind of love. Even though we have a partial understanding of it, I don't know if we'll ever understand exactly how much he does love us. There's this barrier between us and God, and it's our sin. And there was no way to remove that except for Christ coming and living a perfect life and dying on the cross for our sin so that that barrier would be removed. And that sin that is in us, and even though we're saved, that sin is nature is still there. That causes us to believe and to feel that we're the most important thing in the world. And that's the barrier that keeps us from loving others the way we love ourselves. It's because we still have this notion in our head that everything revolves around us. Our opinions are right. The things that we want to do are more important than the guy that's driving 20 miles an hour in front of me. And we believe this. And as long as you think that you're the center of the universe, you will never, ever be able to love somebody more than you love yourself. You just can't do it. But when you have that happen to you, be it your wife, your children, when you understand that kind of love, it's like finding a hidden door in your house, and you open up that door, and here's this huge, huge room you didn't even know was there, and it's filled with amazing, beautiful things. And that's what Christ gives us in an understanding of what love really is. Most of our love is conditional. These people are nice to me, I'm going to love them. As soon as they quit being nice to me, I don't love them anymore. That's the love of the world. That's not the love that God has for us. And it's a good thing that it's not, or none of us would be here. So, unconditional love is a gift of God. It is not natural for us. The very notion of imitating God has to be based on loving Him more than we love ourselves, and loving our neighbors as we love ourselves. And it's all through Scripture. That principle is there. And you can't do that without the Holy Spirit giving you that. It's important, I think, for parents to teach their kids that the world does not revolve around them. Sometimes it's good for a parent to say no, and when they ask you why, you say, because I told you so. Okay? You don't get everything you want in this life. Do you? Do you get everything you want? You don't, do you? And that's probably a really good thing. And probably at least one of you would like to be up here, so I'm glad you can't get it. So, understanding that when God gives us this love, there's stuff that follows from that. And that is, we have to realize that this body of believers here, He loves us all. You understand that? And you know, we're all adopted into His family. We all have an inheritance in Him, as Paul has pointed out. And get this, we're going to spend eternity together in heaven in God's presence. Now, what does that do with, I don't like this person because the things he says really are so wrong? We're to love one another. And we do that because we are a family. And so we imitate God by loving them. And you know how much we're supposed to love each other? The same as you love your children. And the same as hopefully you love your spouse or your parents. That's the kind of love we're to have for each other. I noticed a long time ago, I was praying for somebody one time, and it hit me. Wouldn't I be praying a lot more intense if this was a family member? And I realized we do that. We go through the motions. And yet the love that we're to have for each other is the same because we are family. It should be the same as if it's your child or your parent or your spouse. And so we have a ways to go, and we have to learn the love. If we're going to imitate God, we have to learn how to love one another and to put others first. When God raised us from the dead, we are again formed in the image of Christ. As before, when Adam and Eve sinned, before they sinned, we're in that image, and we have to walk like it, and we have to live like it. And the way we do that is we have to refocus our entire mindset from ourselves to God. That has to be the center. And as children imitate their parents, we have to imitate God. And so because He's holy, what do we have to be? Holy. Because He is kind, Because he's forgiving, we have to be forgiving. And because he is love, we have to walk in the love that God has given to us. And then he goes on in this passage, pointing out that because God is pure, we have to imitate that purity. That's why he says in verse 5, everyone who is sexually immoral or impure, who is covetous as an idolater, has no inheritance of the kingdom of Christ. And God, because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. And I don't know about you, but I know for me, I do not want to feel the wrath of God. And so therefore, I'm going to pay close attention to anything where he specifically says, if you do this, God's wrath is coming on you. In today's world, what are you going to watch on TV? What are you going to read? What are you going to see? What are you going to listen to? Because it's all full of impurities and immorality. It is so easy for us to fudge and to say, well, this is a great movie. Now, it's got a few bad words in it, but other than that, it's okay. What does God call us to? He says, everything that is invisible shall become visible with the light. So the day will come, and I don't know how it's going to work. Maybe it'd be like in here, just put on the screen. Everything we do, everything you've ever thought or done, how would you feel about that? It's great that we're coming to the table today because it's a great opportunity for us. So Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 6:19, or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price, so glorify God in your body. And there's just no way that we can continue in an immoral walk if we're going to be walking as children of the light. And one of the ways we do that is begin to see ourselves as a temple of the living God, that the Holy Spirit lives within us. And there's nothing that gets past him. There's nothing that is hidden. And as children, we have to learn, and we have to obey, and we have to walk knowing that Christ walks with us every step of the way. This is about as clear as it gets. And so, unfortunately, what we try to do in our lives is we try to justify our behavior by a bad interpretation of God's word. And what we want to do in our hearts is to say, well, this is not what this means. What this means is that's back for that generation. That's back for that culture. And we listen to people, and that's why Paul writes in this. He says, let no one deceive you with empty words. And there's lots of false teachers that are going to tell you that this is okay and this is okay. But if God's word says it's not okay, it's not. And we have to believe what God says. We want to be deceived because we want to continue plowing through this life in a narcissistic manner, doing exactly what we want. And then rationalizing it away by listening to some false teacher tell us that it's okay. And what does God say about our hearts and following our hearts? Genesis 6:5 says, the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. So what does that tell us about the way we want to walk? You can't trust yourself. You can't follow our hearts are not a compass to follow. It's only God in his word. He gives us the compass and the things we're to do. And then he goes on and says, we must awake and arise from the dead. Verse 14, awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead. Christ will shine on you. And remember, Paul is writing to believers here. And a lot of times this part of this passage is taken as a call to salvation from those who were spiritually dead. I don't believe that. It's talking to believers who, although they've been made alive in Christ, are still living among the dead and walking among the dead and acting as if they're still dead. 2 Corinthians 6:17 says, therefore go out from their midst and be separate from them. We're commanded to go into all the world and to do what? You know, to spread the gospel message, to disciple people, to mentor them. We are called to be God's ambassadors. And we look sometimes as if our salvation is the end of it. It's like God saved us so we wouldn't have to go to hell. But it's a lot more than that. He saved us to do the work that he has prepared for us. Yeah, we are saved from the fires of hell. Yes, we are adopted into his family. But look what Paul writes earlier in this book, Ephesians 2:10. He said, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which he has prepared in advance for us, that we should walk in them. We got a limited number of opportunities. I don't know about you. Maybe you're not, but I'm getting older. Okay? And every single second, my time's getting shorter. Therefore, my opportunities to serve the Lord is getting shorter as well. Do you want to be laying on your deathbed and suddenly have this light bulb go off and say, man, I wasted it. I wasted all these opportunities. Every day, we have the opportunity to spread the seed of Christ that others may come to faith in him. And we know that it's the work of the Holy Spirit to bring them to faith, but it's our work to spread that news in the way we act and the way we talk. If you're not living the gospel out in your life, no one's going to listen to you. If you're not walking in the light yourself, Jesus said that he came to seek and save those who are lost. And all the imitations we're doing to God, we got to do that too. We have separated ourselves from them in our words, in our actions, but we have to have a passion, a deep passion for the lost. Just imagine for a minute that all of us, the whole church, goes on a picnic. And we go to a place where there's, you know, we're playing softball and throwing horseshoes and, of course, eating because we do that best. And there's a river there. And we see that there's a boat full of kids. And the boat turns over and the boat sinks and the kids are just floundering around in the water trying to stay their heads up. And that river's moving to a deep, deep waterfall. Are we going to continue our games? No, we're going to get together as a church and we're going to find some way to get those kids out of the water. You know, maybe we're going to build a human chain or something, but we're not going to just stand there by the shore and when they go by say, hey, we're praying for you. But that's what we do. That's what we do as a body of believers. This world is a huge river, and in it is filled with people who are drowning, who are ignorant, that do not believe in Jesus, that do not know him. And we're standing by the way saying, man, do you see the way she's dressed? That's disgusting. You hear that music he's listening to? Our call is to bring them the word of Christ, which is the life jacket, to get them out of that water. And what we need to do is to keep a picture in our mind that if we saw the drowning children in the river, we'd do everything we could to save them. That's the kind of urgency we need in our lives for the lost. How much urgency do you feel for that? There is a pit of hell, and non-believers are floating, walking, running towards it. And we have to do something to get into their lives to explain. They may not come, but when you go with the word of the gospel to them, you are doing what God has commanded you to do. And the rest of it is up to Him and His Holy Spirit. Do you live in the same way that the lost do? Are there things in your life that you need to get rid of? Are you walking in the light of Christ? We're running out of time, and we have to be active in doing the things that God commands us to do, not to earn a salvation, because you can't do that. He has given us that through His blood, but He calls us to work for Him. You got to be willing to sacrifice. You got to be willing to love God and others unconditionally. And I'm not sitting here saying that it's easy. And will you do that? If you're here today and you're not a believer, you're in that river and you're heading for a waterfall that's going to lead you right to hell. And you shouldn't be scared into salvation. But there's an obvious choice there. For those who are not a believer, you can be part of God's family and you can understand what it's like to be in a family with an eternity that promised to us that is going to be more glorious than anything you can think of. And there has to be within us, just like there is with your child, a willingness to sacrifice for them. That's what we have, a willingness to sacrifice. And I'm telling you, if you're here today and you're not a believer, you have an opportunity. You're not here by accident. God brought you here for some reason.